Hey, all you physicists, welcome to the next modern physics lesson. And today we're going to be talking about the photoelectric effect. So this was conducted by Einstein a few years after Max Planck's solution to the ultraviolet catastrophe from the previous lesson. And basically what the photoelectric effect is the phenomenon when okay, so take for example a metal. So let's say this is the surface of a metal and the metal is here, like, this is the metal, right? And in a metal there are atoms, and in their atoms and surrounding the atoms we have electrons. So let's say here are some of the electrons that are on the surface of the metal, so near the surface of the metal. Okay, so what the photoelectric effect is the phenomenon when you have incident light that hits the metal. So let's say we have some like light source. I'm going to draw like some like a box or a camera kind of thing that emits light, and according to classical physics, we're gonna assume that it's basically a wave, and this wave hits the metal. And what happens is, once the light hits the metal, it causes one of the it causes the electrons from the surface, a few of the surface electrons, to bounce right off to get emitted. So one of these gets emitted, and we'll see it bouncing off. And this electron that gets emitted from the metal is called a photo. Oh, oops, photoelectron. And this is the photoelectric effect. So when you hit light, when you shine any form of electromagnetic radiation, but mostly like UV rays, visible light, or X rays, most commonly. What happens is, when you shine those kind of lights to at the surface of a metal, the metal would eject of photoelectrons. Okay, so the reason why this is so crucial to the photoelectric effect is that the classical way of thinking of light, that light is basically waves, didn't work. So the photoelectric effect helped to prove that light behaves as particles and not as waves. So, according to if the classical wave theory of light was true, the following should happen. So, according to the wave theory, of light, so the classical way of thinking, according to the wave theory, the following should be true. Number one, that there is some significant time delay between the what's it called? The hitting of the light on the metal and the ejection of the photoelectron. So a significant delay between incidence, I guess, incidence and ejection. Ejection. So there's some significant time delay between the time when it hit the metal and the time that the photoelectron got emitted, because it took time for the electron to gain the energy from the wave and then get emitted. And secondly, that the intensity of the light will increase the kinetic energy of the ejected photoelectron. So the intensity affects kinetic energy of photoelectron. And thirdly, that the photoelectrons will be emitted regardless of the frequency of the incident light, as long as the intensity of that light was high enough. So, photoelectrons, I'm going to say PE. Photoelectrons will be emitted regardless of frequency. Okay, but what happened was, when experiments were conducted, that it turned out that all three of these were false. This one was false, this was false, and this was false. The first one was that there was actually almost no time delay, that the delay between incident and ejection was basically like a billionth of a second. So basically, you can say that there was no delay between incident and ejection. So number one was false. Number two, the classical wave theory would say that the intensity affects the kinetic energy of the photoelectron. However, it was found out that increasing the intensity only increases the number of photoelectrons emitted. So intensity increases number of PE emitted. And the actual kinetic energy of the photoelectrons that were emitted had a maximum. So there was a maximum KE. There was a KE maximum for the photoelectrons. So number two is false because the intensity didn't affect the kinetic energy at all. There was some maximum. And thirdly, which was that the photoelectrons that are emitted will be emitted regardless of frequency. And this was false again, because there was a threshold frequency. There was a minimum frequency for the photoelectrons to be emitted at all. So there is a threshold frequency for, oh, oops, for, that's not the correct for that I'm looking for PE to be emitted. Okay, so we can see that 1, 2, and 3, all the postulates that the wave theory would state are all false. Okay, so Einstein had to come up with a solution to this and to explain why that the wave theory didn't work for explaining the photoelectric effect. So what Einstein did was he followed Max Planck's way of thinking, and he said that what if that light behaved, that light was emitted as particles, I mean as bundles, that the light emitted here was actually emitted in bundles of light that strikes the metal. And he said that each of this bundle had an energy that was proportional to frequency, and this was his equation for it, where H was Planck's constant. And again, Planck's constant is 6.63 times 10 to the negative 34 joules second. Okay, so each photon, each bundle of light has an energy that was equal to the frequency times Planck's constant. Okay, so let's go back to the diagram. So each of these, now light doesn't behave like a wave anymore according to Einstein. It behaves as a particle. And when the particle strikes the electrons on the surface of the metal, what happens is the electron absorbs the energy immediately. So disproving number one, it absorbs the energy of the photon immediately. And depending on the energy, it may or may not get emitted. And the reason why it might not get emitted is because there is a certain energy required to even liberate it, to get the electron free from the surface. And this energy that is required to free the electron from the surface is called the work function, also known as this, and I'm not Greek, so I don't know what that is. Okay. And basically, what the work function is the energy needed to liberate the photoelectrons from the surface of the metal. And this differs depending on, I guess, surface. So depending on the object, the metal, aluminum, whatever, depending on the metal, the work function differs. Okay, so let's go back to the so let's try to find out number two, explain number two. Why is it that there is a maximum kinetic energy? Okay, So we know that I'm going to draw the diagram again instead of going up and down. I'm going to draw that quick diagram. So we know that photons here is reflecting the surface of the metal, and then there are little electrons here, and the electron gets emitted out into space. Okay, so we know that this one has an energy that is equal to HF, and we know that to even liberate this from the metal, we need an energy that is equal to this, and then after that, the kinetic energy would be whatever's left over. So we can say that the kinetic energy, maximum, I guess, the maximum kinetic energy that can be emitted, the maximum kinetic energy of the electron after it's emitted, is equal to the original energy, so the energy of the photon, minus the already used up energy that was needed to even liberate it from the surface. And this is the equation that calculates how much kinetic energy the photoelectron will have. So the original energy of the photon gets absorbed by the photoelectron, and a bit of that energy is used to even to get it out of the surface. Then once it's out of the surface, the rest of the energy that's left is converted to kinetic energy. And this disproves number two, and explains why that there was a maximum kinetic energy, because it depended on the frequency of the light. And this leads on to question to number three. I mean, two and three are really, really similar. Like, both of them are interconnected. So let's go back to why there is a threshold frequency. Okay. So we know that there is some sort of energy needed, the work function, to liberate it. So what is the minimum amount of energy needed to liberate the electron? And that would be when there is zero kinetic energy. So let Ke max equal zero. So this is the extreme case when there is just enough energy to liberate the photoelectron. So if Ke max equals zero, we have the E of photon minus the work function. And let's rearrange this. And we have the E of photon equals the work function. And what was the formula for the photon, or the energy of the photon again? It was E equals HF. So let's substitute this back in. And I'm going to use red. HF equals work function, and we can substitute this, and we can say that the threshold frequency equals work function over H. And the reason why I put a zero there is I'm basically this is the symbol for threshold frequency, the minimum frequency needed to even liberate the photoelectron from the surface of the metal. So this is the formula for the threshold frequency of the photoelectron. And this explains the third explanation. Okay, so we know that there is some sort of threshold frequency for the photoelectron to be emitted, but how about the intensity thing? Like, what does intensity affect if it doesn't affect kinetic energy or the emission of a photoelectron? Well, basically, what Einstein said, according to his photon theory of light, is that intensity just increases the number of photons. So intensity is proportional to the number of photons. So when you increase intensity, you increase the number of photons that are hitting the metal. And we can see here, I guess we'll use the one on top. So if you increase the intensity here, what you would see is tons and tons of more photons that are hitting the metal. And because there are more photons to interact with the electrons. So each one goes to each electron, and since there are more photons now, there are more electrons that are interacted with. And due to that, there are more photoelectrons that are emitted. And then, like, all these get emitted. Like that, blah blah blah, boom boom boom, a lot of them. So increasing the intensity increases the number of photons, and this results in an increase in the number of photoelectrons emitted. And that is basically what intensity affects. So we know intensity affects the number of photons, and hence the number of photoelectrons emitted. And frequency affects This is just a little recap of what I talked about. Frequency affects the energy of the photon, and hence the kinetic energy of the photoelectron. Okay, and that's it. This is a basic recap of what we talked about this whole unit. So, yeah, I hope you can see how the use of quantum theory explains the photoelectric effect, because it explains how it disproves the classical wave theory, and that in that there is no delay, there is the intensity does not affect kinetic energy, it affects the number of photons that are hitting the metal, and therefore the number of photoelectrons getting emitted, and photoelectrons will not be emitted if the frequency is lower than the threshold frequency. So frequency is important in the emission of photoelectrons. And yep, that's it. So hopefully you guys see how quantum theory prevails over classical theory, and how light behaves not as a wave for this experiment, but as photons, as quantums of light, as packets of energy. And just a quick recall that each packet of energy, each photon has an energy of HF, because this formula is really important in quantum theory. Okay, so just a quick disclaimer, this quick warning that light does not always act as photons. It acts as waves sometimes. So don't just rule out the classical wave theory. I mean, since it held for over a century, I mean, it had to be doing something right. So the thing about light is that it behaves both as a wave and a particle, and I'll talk about that later in a future episode. So yeah. For this episode and these few episodes, I'm just explaining how light behaves as a particle, and then I'll move on to talking about how light behaves as a wave. Okay, I'll see you guys next time then. Peace out.